Hello, hello everyone, and welcome back to my channel. I am coming to you from Boston, Massachusetts, a city very close to my heart because I used to live here for a very long time before moving to London. I am currently in the Hilton Logan Airport Hotel, which is literally attached to Terminal E, which is where I'm flying out of bright and early tomorrow morning. But since I've got a few hours in Boston, I thought I would make a little travel vlog. My plan right now is to drop off the rental car and then I'm gonna go head into Boston and see what I can get up to. So let's go spend a lovely few hours in Boston. It's this gorgeous sunny summer day. I wanna get walking. I wanna go revisit some of my favorite spots in the city. And then I've got a lovely dinner with a friend planned in the North End, which is Boston's Italian neighborhood tonight. So if that sounds good, come join me. I'm heading out now. I started my walk around Beacon Hill, which is where I was visiting some friends. Beacon Hill is a wonderfully historic neighborhood. Much of it started to get developed after 1795 when construction started on the Massachusetts State House. And what I recommend is to climb the hills, stroll all of the scenic streets. You never know what you're gonna see in Beacon Hill, including I happened to be there during Pride and saw that somebody turned their window box into stormtroopers, all the colors of the rainbow, which is pretty fabulous. I then wandered along Charles Street, which is a place to go for boutiques, unique restaurants, cafes, and those neighborhoods that you just kind of want to get a little bit lost in, wander, stroll, maybe go have a little bite to eat or a coffee. It's also right next to the Boston Public Garden, which is one of my absolute favorite places to go check out in Boston. The Boston Public Garden is actually the first public botanical garden in America. It was established in 1837, and there is a road that divides the Boston Common, which I'll show you in a little bit, from the Boston Public Garden. But what makes the Boston Public Garden so special is it has a beautiful lake in the middle. It has tons of gorgeous trees, flowers, some manicured hedges, and it really does feel like this calm oasis in the middle of the city. It's the kind of place where if you did want to bring like some sandwiches or, you know, some juices in, you know, just to have like a little picnic, this would be the park I would do it in compared to the Boston Common. It's a lot nicer. It feels safer than the Boston Common. There's a little, some not always the nicest characters hang out in the Boston Common, unfortunately, but the public garden seems to be much more kind of gentrified and safe, which is really lovely. When in the public garden, there's also a famous statue of George Washington. It's actually called the Equestrian Statue of George Washington, and it was commissioned in 1859, but actually dedicated in 1869. And to me, it's the kind of iconic focal point of the Boston Public Garden. After that, I crossed the street toward the Back Bay and did a little loop over one of my favorite walks, which is the Commonwealth Avenue Mall. It is a pedestrian walking path that divides Commonwealth Avenue, or Comm Ave as the locals call it. And it's just a really nice place to have a stroll. This is a very wealthy part of Boston, and all the homes that flank both sides of the Comm Ave Mall are stunning. If you're lucky enough to own or rent in this area, you are definitely doing pretty well. It really is, in my opinion, kind of one of the best areas of Boston. And when I did live, I actually lived on Marlborough Street and much further down from this area on Marlborough Street, but it still remains kind of one of my favorite parts of the city. And I just nostalgically always have to go back and have a stroll and remember kind of when I lived in Boston, because it really is kind of that special. And again, I'm quite an architecture buff, and I just think Boston, it just has so much charm with the iron gates, all of the flowers in front of people's homes, and each home and area is just a little different. So if you really enjoy just kind of imagining what if, and just having a stroll and looking at that architecture, then this is a really great little walk and loop to do. Thank you. I then made my way actually back through the public garden, waved hello to the duck boat. The Boston duck boats are very much a legendary thing to do in Boston. They are a tour that you can pay for. You can Google them, Boston duck tours, and they're really fun, especially if you're with young children or people that are less able to walk. They are kind of World War II amphibious land vehicles. They can drive on the roads, but they can also splash down in the Charles River, which is pretty spectacular. So one last thing to mention before we leave the Boston Public Garden is that I made my way across kind of the famous bridge that cuts across the lake in the middle. And when you do so, if you look on to your right, you will see the famous swan boats. And the swan boats are actually also a very uniquely historical thing to do in Boston. The tradition of having boats in the lake in the Boston Public Garden dates back to 1870 when they just had traditional rowboats. But in 1877, the family that ran the business fashioned these unique boats with swans on the side, which are not operated by like a paddle like you would a rowboat, but they're actually operated almost like a bicycle. And this is also a great activity to do with kids or with those less able. It is just a very uniquely lovely thing to do in Boston. Next up, I made my way over to the Boston Common, which is actually America's oldest park, dating back to 1634. And I have to say, I still don't feel like the Boston Common is as safe as the Boston Public Garden, so just mind yourself a little bit, but it is very historic. It is less charming than the Boston Public Garden, but it does have a very rich history. So it actually used to be used as a cow pasture in the 1600s. It also was used for hangings and also as a camp for the British during the American Revolutionary War. So it's lived many different lives. After the Common, I made my way towards the kind of financial district, waved hello to a few more of those kind of Boston duck tour boats. It's always fun to kind of wave at the people or quack at them. I'm actually walking along the Freedom Trail. So if you are walking along Boston and you see these bricks with like kind of divided in the middle of the pathway, that is actually the Freedom Trail. The Freedom Trail is a 2.5 mile walking path through all of the historic sites of Boston and covers 16 of them to be exact. So if you do want to see me do another vlog on the walking the Freedom Trail in a future video, please leave a comment down below. But my next stop was actually Boston's old City Hall, which dates back to 1865. And actually today is the site of a Ruth Chris restaurant, which is a very kind of posh and fancy steakhouse. Across the way is the Omni Parker House, which I think is the oldest hotel in Boston as well. So everywhere you walk in Boston, there's just so much wonderful history. Even the fact that you can go have a fancy, expensive steak in Boston's old City Hall in a building dating back to the 1800s is actually pretty special. And one of the reasons why, I loved living in Boston, but I also love visiting Boston. And a special fun fact on this plaza is there's also a statue honoring Ben Franklin as well. So again, everywhere you go in Boston, from George Washington to Ben Franklin, there's so much wonderful history that you can see and learn from. Next up, I made my way into Faneuil Hall, which is another wonderfully historic area of Boston. It dates back to 1742, but what's really important about Faneuil Hall is it was dubbed the Cradle of Liberty. And do you want to know why? Well, I'm so happy you asked. It served as a meeting place for the Patriots on the eve of the American Revolution. So there were some very important meetings happening in Faneuil Hall to discuss the Stamp Act, the Boston Massacre, the Tea Crisis, and other grievances that were being held with Britain. All of these meetings happened between 1764 and 1775. Faneuil Hall was also home to merchants, which is something that hasn't changed up until the present. Although back then, those merchants were kind of meat and produce sellers, fishermen, and other kind of peddlers of assorted kind of goods. But today, it's definitely a shopping area. It is very much a touristy area, is what I will say, but if you're thinking of coming to Boston on a touristy kind of trip, then you should definitely check it out. You can go see a lot of, you know, very kind of the stores you would expect, like Urban Outfitters, or there's a very famous Abercrombie & Fitch that has been there for as long as I can remember. You know, Ann Taylor, The Gap, Banana Republic, etc. But there's also some other kind of unique stalls within the Faneuil Hall and Quincy markets themselves, as well as a lot of great restaurants and other kind of touristy sites. When I was there, I actually saw a very large dinosaur and some sort of dinosaur exhibition, which I'm sure my nephew would love, and I'm absolutely going to suggest it to my brother. But yeah, it's just one of those great, very vibrant places in town that if you are coming to a visit on Boston, you should absolutely check out. Next up, I made my way to my final destination before dinner, which is the North End. The North End is actually Boston's Italian neighborhood. So if you're looking for great Italian food, look no further. You definitely should have it in the North End. But the North End is also very historical. There's a number of famous sites from the Revolutionary War, including Paul Revere's house, which you can see up here on the left, as well as the old North Church. And the Freedom Trail does continue to run through the North End. Our final destination for the evening was a fabulous Italian restaurant called Mamma Maria, which does have a wonderful outdoor patio, but because it was cold, I asked my friend if we could sit inside, and it's wonderfully old school inside, but very cozy. It's definitely on the pricier side. I started actually with a mocktail, a virgin mojito, because it just didn't feel like having alcohol at the beginning of the night. That changed later in the evening. And for my main, I ended up having the halibut, which was fantastic. Now, this was $39, so when I say it's a little bit on the pricier side, it is, but it is worth it. Portions were on the small side for the halibut, at least, but I found it absolutely delicious. And my friend had this really cool lobster pasta, which was also similarly priced to my main. So again, portions on the smaller side, but really good food. After dinner, we went to Cafe Paradiso for a pistachio martini. So it's actually a proper martini with pistachio liqueur and a scoop of pistachio gelato inside. This is officially my new favorite dessert cocktail. It is absolutely fantastic. And my friend had a hot chocolate and cannoli, which he said was really good. And then I finished my evening back at the Hilton at Boston's Logan Airport. I'm doing a dedicated hotel room review on this hotel, so stay tuned for that. That's gonna be my next video, but here's just a little teaser of the lobby and a very random historic statue in the lobby. I mean, Boston, there's history everywhere. So thanks again for tuning into this vlog. If you like this video, please hit that like button. Have you been to Boston? What places did you really enjoy checking out? Where did you stay? Leave a comment down below. Sharing is caring here on this channel. I've also done a ton of other Boston travel vlogs and hotel room review vlogs. So I'm gonna leave that all linked down below, as well as every place mentioned in this video as usual. So please also hit that subscribe button if you want to see more of my travel vlogs. Thanks again for tuning in, guys, and I will see you soon.